Hello guys, welcome back. Myself Pushpender Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 6th of May 2021, and how are you all? These lectures are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC. Okay, and you should be studying the national newspapers like Hindu or Indian Express for that purpose. Okay, and you can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on a day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe the channel on the YouTube where you will get the daily current affairs related lectures. Alright, so let's begin with the lecture for the 6th May 2021. Okay, the first news is related to some of the steps which are taken to ease some of the burdens, right, on the various segments of the economy by the RBI. So RBI has taken several steps, right, or several moves to lower down the burden which was caused by the COVID-19 and the pandemic and related lockdown and the imposition of those restrictions, right? So certain segments of the economy are facing very, very difficulties in terms of those, various aspects. So RBI has taken the step to ease down those burden. Okay. So current RBI governor, Mr. Shaktikant Das, have announced a series of the measures, right, to support definitely the nation and its various sectors to fight the second wave of corona or second wave of COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, which is basically affecting almost every sector in our country. So here in the first measure, right, the term liquidity facility, right, that has been provided of around 50,000 crore rupees, right, which will have the tenure of up to 3 years, right, at the repo rate that has been provided, or that has been the one of such step have been provided by the RBI. The main purpose of providing this term liquidity facility, right, that to the tenure of around 3 years, right, to basically ease some of the health services which are currently under the strain or stress, right, as well as to revamp up certain health related infrastructure and the services. So this liquidity facility will definitely help in the health related infrastructure and their build up and their associated services. Okay, now here the term repo rate, right, that will be provided. What is repo rate? See, repo rate is basically a rate at which the central government, right, central government here, basically your Reserve Bank of India. So here a central, central bank. So what is repo rate? Repo rate, you can say again, see, it is a rate at which the central bank again, the Reserve Bank of India, lends the money to the commercial banks, right? So what is the purpose of lending this money from RBI to the commercial bank? Definitely to fulfill any shortfalls of the funds. Okay, so the repo rate basically used by the monetary authorities to control the inflation in the economy, right? So here at the repo rate, this term liquidity facility will be available, all right, and that will be basically used for ramping up of the COVID related health infrastructure and the services. Okay, the next is special long-term repo operations for the small financing banks. Okay, now here for the small financing banks, I'll come to that, what is small finance banks, but first let us understand this, then we'll go to the basics of the small finance banks. Okay, so definitely we are also facing very difficulty in terms of the managing of the finance with respect to those small financing banks. So in order to support those small financing banks in terms of providing those support to the small and micro and other sectors of the economy, right, this 3 year repo operations of around 10,000 crore rupees will be provided, right, and that will be provided for the fresh lending up to 10 lakh rupees per borrower, and that facility will be available up to 31st of October 2021. Okay, and the next measure is the lending which will be done by the small financing banks to the micro financing institutions, that is simple, the micro financial institutions, right? So these small financing banks basically lend to the micro financing institutions, right? And such lending, now as per the series of the measures that was implemented by the Reserve Bank of India, such lending would be classified as a priority sector lending. So here, such type of small financing banks, now they are permitted to have the fresh lending. Fresh lending means a fresh amount of the money that will be lent to the microfinancing institutions, and only those microfinancing institutions that are having the asset size of above 500 crore rupees, right? To those, such lending will be classified as a priority sector lending, and thus such facility will be applicable up to 31st of March 2022. That will be definitely helping the sector which requires the priority sector lending. Okay, now let us understand what is this small financing banks, what we are talking about, and what are the series of the steps that are taken. So small financing banks, you can understand it is a basically a financial institutions, definitely. Like the main purpose of the small financing banks is to fund the financing needs of the underprivileged sections, right, of the society, right? Definitely, how would you provide the financing needs? Definitely through the basic banking activities like lending or the deposits, right? So these includes basically, you can understand the small business units like in the rural areas or smaller marginal farmers or unorganized entities or even small and, you know, some of the micro industries also, right? So the main purpose of setting up of these small financing banks to reach out to such unbanked population that are basically reside in rural areas, such as small and marginal farmers, unorganized entities, even small and the micro enterprises also, right? So to reach out such remote and underprivileged areas to provide such financing facilities to those sections of the society. So in nutshell, what you can say that small financing banks are basically it's a basically set up in India on basically on September 16, 2015, right? After the Reserve Bank of India has approved to set up such type of institutions that are known as small financing banks. And these have been provided as per the budget 2014-15, right? So these have set up basically in 2015 onwards under the budget 2014-15, right? And what is this microfinancing institutions? See, microfinancing institutions, you can say these are the financing institutions or simple financing companies that provide the small loans to the people, right? These small loans to the people, only those people, right, which do not have any access to the banking facilities. You're getting my point? So the definition of this small loans that I'm talking about, right, you can say that it varies from country to country, right? Say for example, in India, if you want to say the small loan, right, that is correspond to something which is lesser than or which is below than 1 lakh rupees, right? So if the loan is something which is below than 1 lakh rupees, will be considered as a small loan, and such type of loans will be applicable under this scheme, right? And what is this priority sector lending? You might have heard about through the newspapers also. See, priority sector lending is basically, you know, it's the most important the lending facilities which was provided by the Reserve Bank of India. Right, it is mandated by the Reserve Bank of India to the banks, various banks, right, for the purpose of providing the specified portion of bank lending to the specific sectors. That means the Reserve Bank of India has fixed that the banks has to provide the specific portion of the lending or the bank lending to the specific sectors. Now, what are these specific sectors? For example, agricultural and allied activities, say micro and small enterprises, or you can say the housing for the poor people, or you can say that the loan for the students, right, or education loans, or even some sort of a loans to the low income group or the weaker sections are also comes under the priority sector lending. All right. And certain credit flow to the MSME entrepreneurs also been provided as a measure by the Reserve Bank of India, right, for the purpose to incentivize, right, you know, such micro, small and medium enterprises, that is the micro, small and medium enterprises, okay, to boost those MSMEs, right, and certain MSMEs which are not banked, that means which are not connected with financial institutions or which are not taking the services of the financial institutions, right? So to connect those MSMEs into the banking systems, right, certain exemptions are provided basically in February 2021, right, where the scheduled banks, right, they are allowed to deduct certain credit, right, which were given to the new MSMEs which are not connected or which are unbanked, right, from their net time and demand liabilities, right, that is for the calculation of CRR. Now, this scheme has been extended up to December 31st, 2021. The main purpose of the deduction or allowed this deduction of the credit, right, from basically the net time and demand liability is to enhance, right, you know, some sort of a the efficiency or some sort of a the borrowing capacity of the banks, specifically to such the micro, small and the medium enterprises. Now, you would be thinking, what is this net demand and the net time and the demand liability? See, this is again an economic term. You can understand this net time and the demand liability, or you can say in the nutshell, that is NDTL, that is basically shows the difference between the sum of the demand and the time liabilities, that is the deposits of the bank, right? That is the deposits of the bank, right? You know, with some sort of a public or other bank, and the deposits in the form of assets that are basically held by other banks. So it is something, the difference between such sum. So roughly you can say that the net demand and the time liabilities shows a difference, specifically the sum of the demand and the time liabilities of a particular bank, right, with the deposits in the form of assets which are held by other bank, right? That is basically shown by this. And what is this CRR? CRR basically is also known as the cash reserve ratio. The cash reserve ratio. Now, what is the significance of cash reserve ratio? Right here, in terms of providing such financing facilities to the micro, small and medium enterprises. So the cash reserve ratio is basically, first of all, you must understand, is decided by, some sort of a the RBI Monetary Policy Committee, right? That has been decided in the periodic, you know, the monetary policy, which was decided by the, you know, Reserve Bank of India. So CRR or cash reserve ratio is basically one of the biggest weapon that the Reserve Bank of India has, right? So the main purpose of CRR is to balance the level of the inflation, controlling the money supply, right, controlling the liquidity in the economy. So you can say that if you have the lower CRR, or if you have the lower CRR, right, what will happen? You will have higher liquidity, right, with the banks, right? And then banks can go basically to the investment, right, for major lending, as well as it can also lend more amount of money. So you are getting my point. If such net time and the demand liability that will be, you know, deducted from CRR, that means the CRR will have the higher impact on in terms of the investment lending, as well as other banking facilities that will be provided in terms of the liquidity availability, right? So higher CRR can also, you know, you can understand, if you have lower CRR, that can boost your investment lending facilities and etc. If you have higher CRR, that can also negatively impact the economy, right? So because you won't be having the enough amount of the funds in order to lend to basically to the various purpose, or in order to invest in various purpose, right? So that is basically there. Now, the Reserve Bank of India basically mandate that the banks store a portion of their deposit in the form of cash. Now listen carefully. The Reserve Bank of India mandate that all banks, all scheduled commercial banks or scheduled banks, they should store a portion of their deposits in the form of cash, right? So that at the time, at the same time, they can be given to the bank's customers if the need arises. So the banks has to cap a portion of their deposit in the form of cash, right? Now, the percentage of cash that is required to be kept in the reserve, right, you know, as compared to the bank's total deposit, is known as the cash reserve ratio, right? So here the cash reserve ratio is either stored in the bank's vault or it is sent to the Reserve Bank of India, right? So here banks do not get any interest on the money that they basically, you know, either they kept in their vault or they kept with the RBI, but that is only when the customers require or when the need arises, that money will be paid out of this CRR, right? So that is something, the economic term that you must understand. Okay, now, in order to provide some of the the easiness in terms of the KYC norms, or know your customer, or know your the customer norm, right, certain steps have been taken. So that is, you know, that has the RBI has extended the scope of the video KYC. You might have seen also, if you open your Paytm account, right, there is video KYC norm, right? So here the video KYC norm is applicable to the new customer categories such as proprietary firms, right? Now the RBI also relaxed that there is also possible to convert the limited KYC accounts into fully KYC compliant accounts, right? And the RBI also introduced a more customer friendly option in terms of updating the KYC norms, right? And it also enabled the use of this KYC identifier, right, which is basically for generation of this centralized KYC registry for the purpose of, you know, for the purpose of submission of this electronic documentary as identity proof. Okay. Now, the Reserve Bank of India is also providing certain other relaxations. Now, in terms of the floating provisions or in terms of the counter-cycling provisions buffer, like now the banks can use 100% of their floating provisions, right? Right. That is as on 31st of December 2020, right? And that will be applicable now, and such utilization is permitted up to 31st of March 2022, right? And the relaxation of the overdraft facilities for the state is also been provided. So here, the maximum number of days of such overdraft, right, facility for the state government have been increased from 36 days to 50 days, right? That is basically would have the states specifically to deal out any sort of shortfall of the finance. So what is this overdraft facility? So overdraft facility is basically a finance facility, right? Or you can say it's an instrument that enables, right, to withdraw the money from your, from basically a bank account, right? Even if you do not have your account balance in your account. So that is something, a facility that will enable you to draw some money, even you don't have your the amount, or if you even if you don't have any account balance in your account. So you can say that the banks basically levies an interest rate when you avail such type of overdraft facilities, and such overdraft facility relaxation will be provided to the states in order to get more liquidity, right, in order to get more finance. Okay. Now, stress resolution framework 2.0 for individuals, small business as well as MSMEs. So again, the stress resolution framework. Now you must understand, everyone, right, is facing basically some sort of a non-performing assets or some sort of a stress assets, right? So this stress resolution framework 2.0 have been initiated by the RBI, right, for the purpose of such MSMEs, individual and small businesses, for the purpose of relieving certain stress related to those financial assets. So RBI has announced certain measures to relieve the stress that they are faced by some sort of a vulnerable categories of the borrowers, like you have the individuals, borrowers, or even micro, small and medium industries also, right? So here the RBI has mandated that these vulnerable borrowers, specifically either individuals or the MSMEs, right, which is having the aggregate exposure of around 25 crore, right? Now, there is condition that if they have not availed any sort of restructuring facilities under the previous stress resolution framework 1.0, now they are classified, or who are basically classified, you know, as on 31st March 2021, only such vulnerable borrowers would be eligible to consider under such resolution framework 2.0, right? Now under this stress restructuring or stress resolution framework 2.0, the restructuring under this new framework can be invoked till September 30th, 2021. And that will have to implement within 90 days after invocation. Now, what is this restructuring? Now, you must understand, right? The restructuring, you must understand that, for example, a loan for which a party has agreed to alter the terms. Now, something restructuring, something to alter the terms, right? Terms may be, you know, either the repayment period or either the interest rate, right? Anything that can be altered, right? So a loan for which the party has agreed, now all the parties should be agreed for the purpose, right, to alter the terms, right? What is the purpose of alteration of these terms in terms of restructuring, right? Definitely to make them more favorable to the borrowers. So that is the reason, right, such borrowers or such vulnerable borrowers that are either the individuals or MSMEs, in order to make these loans more favorable to them, right, certain restructuring is done, right? And such restructuring will be done either in the form of the lower interest rate or either in the form of the higher repayment period or maybe another thing, right? So for individuals and the small business, right, who have availed such restructuring of the loans under resolution framework 1.0, right, and that will have the moratorium of less than 2 years, now they are also permitted, right? And now they have now can now increase the period or extend the residual tenure up to 2 years, right, under this new framework. Nine, and the small businesses and MSMEs, now if they have restructured earlier in terms of such type of relaxation or such type of, you know, some sort of a favorable terms or in terms of restructuring of such liable loans, now they have permitted to review the working of the capital sanction limits, right? That is, to review such capital sanction limits or working capital sanction limits, it's a one-time measure that will be provided to such small businesses and MSMEs to recoup such type of stressed assets under Stress Resolution Framework 2.0. Okay, next, the Section 142 of the Social Security Code 2020. Now, the Ministry of Labor and the Employment, right, have basically notified the Section 142 of the Social Security Code. Now, that will be covering the applicability with the help of Aadhaar. So what is this Social Security Code and what is this Section 142? That is that two things that will be coming to your mind. So first of all, the Code of Social Security, or simple the Social Security Code, is basically a code that is basically, you know, implemented by the government of India to amend and to consolidate the laws which are relating to the social security, right? The goal of this Social Security Code is to extend the social security to all employees, to the workers, either they are working in the organized sector or they are working in the unorganized sector or even on any other sector, right? So to have the goal of social security to those employees, right? Okay, now this notification, which was related to this Section 142, right, would enable the Labor Ministry, or simply the Ministry of Labor and the Employment, to collect some of the details or Aadhaar details, right, for the purpose of the database of the beneficiaries, right? These database which is being collected under this Section 142 with the help of this Aadhaar would definitely help those workers, or, you know, some sort of a, you know, the employees to categorize them under various social security schemes, and that will basically help in, you know, the better formulation of those social security schemes for those workers. Now, this national database for the unorganized workers, right, which is currently in the advanced stage of the development, because now we are using this data basically for the purpose of this generation of this database for the unorganized sector, definitely for the purpose of bringing the better social security schemes. Now you would be thinking, what is this unorganized sector? So first of all, unorganized sector is basically defined under Unorganized Workers Social Security Act 2008. Now, what is this unorganized workers? See, unorganized workers, you can understand any sort of a workers that may be some sort of a home-based workers, right, that is working in your homes, right? You might have seen also the maids and all sort of a things. Then self-employed workers, okay, and the wage workers, okay, and that are working basically in the organized sector, or any other worker which are working in the organized sector, but they are not covered under any act which are providing some sort of a social security. Now that will be provided, that will be a definition, or that will be covered under unorganized workers. Now, this portal that will be basically having this database will be having the collection of this data from unorganized workers, right? For example, you have different type of migrant workers that basically move from one region to another region in the search of employment, in the search of, you know, other benefits, right? So to give them a better facilities, to give them a better schemes, right, to formulate a better schemes to them, such collection of the data would definitely help the government of India to enactment of the better policies. And such interstate migrant workers can register themselves, right, on this portal, right, on the basis of this Aadhaar, and so that they can get or they can avail certain set of benefit under this scheme, right? So here the Union Minister of State, what is IC, that is independent charge. That is independent charge. So that is one form of, you can say, that is the one form of your Council of Ministers, right? You have the Council of Ministers, that is, first is Cabinet Ministers, okay? Second is the Minister of State, independent charge. The third is Minister of State without independent charge. And the fourth category of the minister is the Deputy Ministers, the Deputy Ministers. So the Minister of State, independent charge for the labor and the employment, three Santosh Gangwar have clarified that this social security code, which have notified, right, that is only for the collection of data, and he has ensured that, right, that those migrants worker or those unorganized workers, right, those are working in the unorganized sector, right, the benefits will not be denied to them just based or just for the want of an Aadhaar. That means the Aadhaar will not be a restriction for distributing those benefits to those unorganized sector. It will be just an data collection exercise for the purpose of the better formulation of the policies, as ensured by Sri Santosh Gangwar, who is also the, you know, Union Minister of State for the Independent Charge for Labour and the Employment. All right. Next, the export of organic millets grown in the Himalayas to the Denmark. Now you must understand, in a major boost to organic products, right, from Uttarakhand, right, the organic millets have now exported to the Denmark, right? So it is basically one of the important the achievement that India has achieved in terms of exporting this organic millets to the Denmark, specifically from Uttarakhand. Now the EPIDA, which is basically, you know, Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority, that is Agricultural and Processed Food Export Processed Products Export Development Authority, in collaboration with Uttarakhand Agriculture Produce Marketing Board, as well as Just Organic, which is basically an exporter which exports such organic millets. Now they have, you know, they have basically, you know, exported or sourced this ragi, that is finger millet, right? Then jhingora, which is basically one-eyed millet, right? Specifically from Uttarakhand to the Denmark, right? And such millets have now qualified, right, to be categorized as a standard of European Union, which have been set by the European Union. Now, let us understand what is this EPIDA. EPIDA is basically the Agriculture and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. It is an basically APEX, Export Trade Promotion Active Government Body, which is set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. It has been set up under EPIDA Act 1985, right? And what is this millets? Now, you would have listened this millet, and many of you would be understood this millet also. Now, you must understand, the millet is basically group of highly variable small seed grass, right? It is basically grown around the world, specifically that has been used either for the purpose of, you know, for the fodder or for the purpose of human food also. So it is an important crop, specifically in the semi-arid portion of Asia, specifically in India. Okay, so you have different type of millets. For example, you have sorghum millet. Sorghum ka matlab hota hai sorghum. You might have heard about, right? The sorghum millet is one type of millet. The sorghum ka matlab hota hai basically jowar. You might have heard also, right? Then you have the finger millet. Okay, that is basically your ragi. You might have heard also, right? Then you have other type of millet, like you have the foxtail millet, pearl millet, right? Then you have the Bernard millet, right? Little millet, right? Different type of millets are there, right? For the purpose of this umbrella term. Okay, now the millets are gaining a lot of popularity, specifically globally, because it has high nutritional value, right? And it is also the gluten free, which is also good for the health, Now, the oil cake meal is also one of the important commodity of organic product that has been recently been exported from India to the Denmark, right? Other items that have been exported is basically the oil seeds, fruit pulps, right? Purees, cereals, millets, spices, tea, medicine plants, and other products also. Okay. Now, what you need, basically the organic products which are exporting, right? They should be processed, they should be produced, and they should be packed and labels as per, you know, the National Program for Organic Production. This is basically the umbrella program for the purpose of the production of, or for the purpose of promotion of this organically produced food in India, right? Now, all such products should be produced, processed, and packed under as per the requirement of this NAPOP or National Program for Organic Production. Okay, now this National Program for Organic Production have been implemented by EPIDA, right, since 2001, and it has been notified under Foreign Trade Development Regulation Act 1992, right? So here, regarding some news related to this NAPOP or National Program for Organic Production, So at the Ministry of Industries and the Commerce, I have initiated this national program for organic production. What is the purpose of initiating of this national program for organic production is to assist the organic producers to tap the export markets, right? Specifically, you know, in the foreign countries as well as domestic markets also. Okay. Now, this NEPO or basically your, you know, the national program for organic production have been recognized by the Food Safety Standard Authority of India as a trade of organic products in the domestic market. Okay. Now the organic products which are covered under this, you know, NPO also covered under bilateral agreement, which is basically between India and other nations. Now, related to this FSSAI or Food Safety and Standard Authority of India. So FSSAI is basically a statutory body which have established by the Ministry of Health and the Family Welfare, Government of India. So FSSAI is basically established under Food Safety and Standard Act 2006. Okay, and it is basically consolidating some of the statutes which are related to the food safety and regulations, food safety and regulations under Government of India. Okay, so here you have the Denmark. You can understand that Denmark is also part of your Scandinavian countries, right? So it is basically a Scandinavian a country, right? Which is basically comprising a Jutland Peninsula, right? Where you can see Jutland Peninsula, and as well as you have the numerous islands also, right? Its capital is Copenhagen. It is clearly visible here, and it is basically home of, you know, several royal palaces in the Denmark. Okay, next, the IDBI Bank Limited. Okay, now as a part of the Government of India's move, right, which is on the privatization, right, the Government of India or the Cabinet Committee on the Economic Affairs, right, that have given in principle approval for strategic disinvestment specifically in the IDBI Bank Limited, right? The strategic disinvestment, which is something related to the transfer of the management control in the IDBI Bank Limited. Now the Government of India is facing huge shortage in terms of the finance. Now they are trying to privatize almost every sector, right? That is the reality of the current government policy, right? Now they are trying to privatize this IDBI bank also, right? So here you must understand they are trying to transfer the management control of the IDBI bank in the private hands. So here the extent of the shareholding that is being divested, right, by the Government of India or LIC, right, that will be decided at the time of structuring of such transactions. So current holding of the share, you can say that the Government of India currently holding 45.48% of the share, right? And LIC, which is holding around 49.24% of the share. So both Government of India and LIC both account for 94% of the equity specifically in the IDBI bank. And the Life Insurance Corporation of India or LIC is currently a promoter of IDBI bank, right? And the LIC is also having the management control. And the Government of India, which is currently having around 45.48% of the equity in the IDBI bank, is basically co-promoter. Okay. Now, regarding certain information regarding IDBI bank. So, IDBI bank is also known as the Industrial Development Bank of India. Industrial Development Bank of India. It was established in 1964. Okay. By an act. So, the main purpose of setting up of this IDBI bank is to provide the credit and other financing facilities for the development, right, specifically of the fledgling Indian industry, right? So it is a development financial institutions and the subsidiary of Life Insurance Corporation. Now, what is this strategic disinvestment? You must also understand that here is clearly written that it is a transfer of management control. So here you can say that the strategic disinvestment imply the sale of substantial portion of the government's shareholding, right, specifically in this IDBI Bank Limited. So it will substantially decrease, you know, the government shareholding, right, and here, you know, the transfer of the management control will be inevitable. So here the strategic disinvestment, you can understand, is a transfer of the ownership and the control of any entity, that is probably any public sector entity, that is IDBI Bank Limited, right, mostly to the private sector, in the hands of private sector. So here the RBI LIC board have already passed a resolution to that effect that the LIC may reduce its shareholding, which is currently around 49.24% in the IDBI Bank Limited, right, through divesting, right? And here some sort of a management control is also being relinquished, right, to the private sectors, right? And it will be taken into the consideration of the market outlook, statutory, you know, stipulation, as well as the interest of the policy of stakeholders. Okay, now the government as well as the LIC have both are claiming that such type of strategic buyer, that is basically any private player, okay, would infuse the funds new technology, best management practices, right, for the optimum development of the business, right, business potential, and that will develop more business specifically, right, for the public needs, and that will also cut down the dependence on the LIC or the government assistance or the government funds, okay, and the resource through the strategic disinvestment, right, that would be used to finance the development programs of the government of India. So that is again a privatization policy of the government of India. They will get this fund through the strategic disinvestment from the private player. This fund they will consume in the form of development program. That is what I can say, that simply they are planning to privatize everything, right? That is something that is going on, right? Okay, fine. Next you have the India-UK MOU on the migration and the mobility partnership. So here MOU means Memorandum of Understanding. So India and the United Kingdom both have signed an MOU for migration and the mobility for the purpose of students, scientists, and for the purpose of migration of the people, right? So here the MOU have been approved. So cabinet approved this MOU between India and the United Kingdom, as well as the Northern Islands, specifically for the migration and mobility partnership. Now you would be thinking, UK is simple, UK is basically a country. Well, what is this Northern Ireland? Now that you will be thinking, what is this Northern Ireland? So Northern Ireland is basically a part of the United Kingdom. Sometime many people described it as a country or province or territory or a region, but it is a part of the United Kingdom. Okay, it is basically located in the northeast of the island of Ireland. Okay, or you can say that Northern Ireland shares a border to the south and the west with the Republic of Ireland. Okay, so now the Union Cabinet has approved the signing of this MOU on the migration and the mobility, specifically between India and the Great Britain and the Northern Ireland. Okay, now definitely this, as the name itself suggests, it is basically for the mobility, right? So here this MOU would definitely liberalize certain visa requirement, that is for the purpose of the mobility of the peoples, like the students, researchers, and the skilled professionals. They can move from Britain to India, from India to Britain, right, for the purpose of various purposes, right? And here some sort of a cooperation, specifically in the irregular migration as well as the human trafficking, also will be controlled with the help of the mobility partnership MOU that has been signed between India and UK, right? So here you can understand that this MOU would definitely benefit the Indian students, academicians, researchers, migrants, right, which are working as a professionals or for the economic regions, right? And definitely that will boost the bilateral relations between the two countries, and that will bring the economic development to both of the countries, right, without having any consideration of caste, creed, religion, or gender, or any sort of a place of birth, right? So here that will basically also, that MOU that has been approved by the cabinet, that MOU would also support the innovation ecosystem, right, in the both of the countries. So the Ministry of External Affairs would closely monitor, right, this implementation of MOU through a joint working group mechanism that has been set up by the government of India. Okay, next, the Global Innovation Partnership. Now this global innovation partnership is basically again between India and the UK. Between India and the UK, because both are basically are having some sort of a partnership in terms of innovation, right? And the Union Cabinet has given the approval for signing of this MOU between the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, as well as the Foreign Commonwealth and Development Office of the United Kingdom on the Global Innovation Partnership. So both the India and the UK both will launch a Global Innovation Partnership. This Global Innovation Partnership, or under this Global Innovation Partnership, right, there will be some sort of a support that will be provided to the poor countries or the developing countries, specifically in the African countries or in the third countries or in the new markets, right? So here under Global Innovation Partnership, right, the Indian innovators, right, would scale up their innovations in the third countries. These third countries may be the poor countries, developing countries, say the African countries or in the Asian countries also. So Indian innovators would definitely scale up their innovations. What will happen? That will boost our innovation ecosystem in our country, and that will be self-sustainable, and that will definitely bring more economic growth, right? So here, your Global Innovation Partnership, that is GIP, would focus on sustainable development goals, right? Which are basically assisting some sort of a recipient countries or third world countries to achieve their goals, or to achieve their sustainable development goals. So here under this Global Innovation Partnerships, right, certain other facilities will be provided like seed funding, grants, investment, technical assistance, partnership, that will be provided with the help of the Indian entrepreneurs as well as the innovators, right? And that will be basically for the purpose of providing innovative solutions to selective developing countries so that they can achieve their sustainable development goals. They can achieve their goals for the purpose of economic and social development, right? And this Global Innovation Partnership would also develop an open and inclusive e-marketplace, that is e-Bazaar, right? This e-Bazaar is basically for cross-border innovation transfer, right, across the borders, and that will focus on, you know, some sort of a the assessment that will be based on the results, right? And that is based on the promoting of transparency and accountability between those nations. Okay, regarding the sustainable development goals, you know very well about sustainable development goals. These sustainable development goals are basically a global goals that are collection of 17 global goals that are designed to be blueprint to achieve a better and more sustainable future for all. Okay, now these sustainable development goals are set up in 2015, right, by United Nations General Assembly or UNGA, right, and they are intended to be achieved by 2030. All right, let's move to the new news. Okay, the drones, you know, they are also known as unmanned aerial vehicles or simply UAVs, right? So Ministry of Civil Aviation have granted granted conditional exemption to such unmanned aerial vehicles or unmanned aircraft systems, right, to basically conduct some sort of a beyond visual line of sight experimental flights, right, of the drones for the purpose of, you know, for the purpose of the delivery operations, right, for the purpose of sending certain deliveries with the help of drones, like, you know, you can send some sort of a vaccine or you can send some sort of a the goods and services also with the help of these drones. So such type of conditional exemptions are provided under Unmanned Aircraft System Rules 2021 to 20 such entities to conduct such visual beyond visual line of sight. So here such preliminary permission have been granted, right, definitely to assist, right, to develop certain framework for the using of the drone for the purpose of conducting this beyond visual line of sight, right, with the help of these drones for the purpose of the future drone deliveries, right. That will be the major application for the purpose of sending or for the purpose of using this drone for the purpose of sending those deliveries. And it has been already been executed in some of the Western countries like USA or UK. Okay. So here the central government has constituted this, which is basically the beyond, you know, visual line of sight, that is BVLOS, right? Drone operations, that will be, you know, some sort of a committee they have set up for the purpose, that is the beyond visual, you know, line of sight experimental assessment and monitoring committee, that is known as BEAM committee, have been set up by the government of India to invite an expression of interest for the purpose of undertaking this exercise. What is this exercise? To conduct this beyond visual line of sight experimental flights, right? Experimental flights with the help of these drones. And for the purpose, 20 such entities have been invited, and an expression of interest have already been invited by or already been issued by the Directorate General of Civil Aviation for the aforementioned purpose, that is for conducting this experimental flights of the drones for the purpose of the delivery of those, you know, essential items or maybe delivery of certain products. So here the BEAM committee, which is also known as the BB loss experimental assessment and monitoring committee, or you can say that the beyond visual line of sight, the experimental assessment and monitoring committee, which have evaluated 34 such expression of interest. EOI means expression of interest, right? Which have been received, by basically, by the Directorate General of Civil Aviation, right? And which have selected 20 such consortia for the purpose of this experimental flights. Now, these exemptions which are subjected to complete adherence to such requirement, right? Which are preliminary exemption which are given, right? By the Directorate General, of Civil Aviation. And such exemption period is valid for the period of 1 year or until further orders. It is not for forever, but it is only for certain period only. Okay. So that is all about the drone. You can understand here. You can see this unmanned aerial vehicle that is also known as drone. Okay. Next, Mamata Banerjee. As you know, the Mamata Banerjee is basically, or Trinamool Congress have won the election in the West Bengal. And she would be returning to the power third time as the Chief Minister of West Bengal. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi have congratulated Ms. Mamata Banerjee for taking an oath as a West Bengal Chief Minister for the third time. The Mamata Banerjee was born in 1955 and she would be serving the 8th Chief Minister of the West Bengal as well as the current Chief Minister of West Bengal. And she is currently in the power since 2011 continuously. So she will be holding the third term, and she was the first woman to hold this office as the Chief Minister of West Bengal. Okay. Regarding this party called All India Trinamool Congress, the All India Trinamool Congress was formed by the Mamata Banerjee in 1998 when she was separated from Indian National Congress, and the Mamata Banerjee have become the first chairperson of the All India Trinamool Congress. The Mamata Banerjee have already held some important portfolios under Government of India. For example, she was the first woman to held, right, the Ministry of Railways twice, right, and she was also the first female Minister of Coal. She was also the Minister of Human Resource Development. She was also a Minister of Youth Affairs. She was also a Minister of Sports, Women and the Child Development, specifically in the Cabinet of Indian National Congress. Okay, she is Mamata Banerjee, who have won the election, and she is returning to the power as a third time, right, as a third term as a Chief Minister of West Bengal. Okay, next, the Philippos Mar Chrysostome Marthoma, right? He is basically a person, or you can say he is basically a bishop who recently died. Okay, now the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have condoled, right, the demise of the bishop named as the most rev Dr. Philip Mar, the Chrysostome Marthoma Villa Metropolitan, right? It is the name of the bishop who has recently died, right? So the Philippos Mar Chrysostome Marthoma Villa Metropolitan was born basically in 1970. He died in 2021. He was basically an Indian prelate, right? As well as the Emeritus Metropolitan of the Malankara Marthoma Syrian Church. It is a church name which is located in Kerala, right? He was bishop for this church called Malankara Marthoma Syrian Church for 67 years, 11 months and 13 days, right? And he is also known as Indian prelate. Now that thing coming to my mind, what is this prelate and some information about the Malankara Marthoma Syrian Church. So Malankara Marthoma Syrian Church is basically is a church, or you can say it is a reformed Syrian church, right? It is located, in the autonomous, it is located in basically in the Kerala state in India. And what is this prelate? Prelate, you can say it is a high ranking member of clergy. Clergy, you can understand just like, some sort of a sadhu, right? So it's a high ranking member of a clergy, right, who is an ordinary but who ranks in the precedence with the ordinaries, right? This word called prelate is basically derived from the Latin term called prelatus, right, which means carry before, right? So he is basically the high ranking member of clergy, right? And he was also known as the Chrysostome through many, or Balia through many, and he was also awarded the Padam Bhushan in 2018. Now you must understand the Philippos Mar Chrysostom was also the longest or India's longest service bishop who died at the age of 103. He died at the age of 103. He was India's longest serving bishop, or he was India's longest serving prelate, or the high ranking the member of clergy. And he was also awarded the Padma Bhushan in 2018. Okay. And regarding this Navati Home project, now you must understand the Navati Home project was basically initiated, by this Mar Thoma Church, which is located in the Kerala, as a part of birthday celebrations, right? To definitely to support and enable 1500 families in India, right? Irrespective of any caste, creed or religion, definitely to build their home. So here under this Navati Home project, 1500 families are basically supported by the Mar Thoma Church with the help of some sort of a financial assistance for the building of their home. And the bishop or the Philippos Mar Chrysostom Mar Thoma Metropolitan completed the 90 years on 2008, and he was 103 when he is basically died. Okay, so he is the person whose full name is basically, you can understand, right? Philippos Mar Chrysostom Mar Thoma Velia Metropolitan, right? He was born in 1917 and he died in 2021. Okay, he recently died. Okay, so that's all for today. So I thank you very much, and please take care of yourself from the corona, and definitely I'll see you tomorrow for the right time for our next current affairs. So please take care of yourself. Thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you.